cannot be traveled to earned or won. It is the spiritual experience of living every time with love, grace and gratitude. A very happy morning to all. This is Gayatri of 7A welcoming all of you to the vibrant episode of Chris Vibes powered by English Department. Today, we have with us the very talented students of Christchurch to take us to the birth of English language and literature. This episode is going to be an infotainment where you learn and enjoy. Let's first get introduced to literature and its classification. Here comes a well-planned PowerPoint presentation.
What is literature? Literature broadly is any collection of written work, but it is also used more narrowly for writings specifically considered to be an art form, especially prose fiction, drama and poetry. In recent centuries, the definition has expanded to include oral literature, much of which has been transcribed. Literature as an art form can also include works in various non-fiction genres such as biography, diaries, memoir, letters, and the essay. Within its broad definition, literature includes non-fictional books, articles, or other printed information on a particular subject. Types of literature. The main types of literature are drama, fable, autobiography, biography, poetry, prose, and science fiction. Drama. Drama is literature intended for performance. The form is combined with music and dance in opera and musical theatre. A play is a written dramatic work by a playwright that is intended for performance in a theatre. Fiction and its subtypes. Folklore. Folklore refers to the tales people tell, folk stories, fairy tales, tall tales, and even urban legends. Romance novel or romantic novel is a type of genre fiction novel which places its primary focus on the relationship and romantic love between two people and usually has an emotionally satisfying and optimistic ending. Non-fiction and its subtypes. One of the most popular subtypes of non-fiction is autobiographies. An autobiography is a self-written account of one's life. Autobiography takes stock of the autobiographer's life from the moment of composition. Poetry. Poetry is literature that evokes a concentrated imaginative awareness of experience or a specific emotional response through language chosen and arranged for its meaning, sound, and rhythm.
You bring to the act of photography all the pictures you have seen, the books you have read, the music you have heard, the people you have loved. Here, my friends, Abhijit and Aruman of grade 11A show their exquisite talent in photography. It's soothing for eyes and mind to enjoy their photographs with subtle thoughts. Enjoy.
Thank you.
have understood about the classification of literature. Thank you, my dear friends, for that wonderful video. Now let's get into poetry, welcoming the dear little ones to present before you one of the best poems of Tagore.
Good day all. When the mind is without fear is a poem written by 1913 Nobel laureate Rabindranath Tagore. It represents his vision of a new and awakened India. It is an expression of the poet's reflective spirit and contains a simple prayer for his country, the India of pre-independence times. Here, my friends and I recite the poem where the mind is without fear. Where the mind is without fear and the head is held high, where the knowledge is free, where the world has not been broken up into fragments by narrow domestic rules. Where the mind is without fear and the head is held high, where the knowledge is free, where the world has not been broken up into fragments by narrow domestic walls.
Where words come out from the depth of truth, where tireless striving stretches its arms towards perfection, where clear stream of reason has not lost its way into the dreary desert sand of dead habit, where words come out from the depth of truth, where tireless striving stretches its arms towards perfection, where clear stream of reason has not lost its way into the dreary desert sand of dead habits.
Where the mind is led forward by thee into ever-widening thought and action, into that heaven of freedom, my father. Let my country awake, let my country awake.
Where the mind is led forward by thee into ever-widening thought and action, into that heaven of freedom, my father, let my country awake. Let my country awake.
Hello everyone, I'm Anne George of 11B. I would like to introduce you to a famous play which has its significance in our present scenario. The play is Henrik Ibsen's A Doll's House. Ibsen was inspired by the belief that a woman cannot be herself in the modern society as it is an exclusively male society. Henrik Ibsen describes the story of a married woman named Nora who considered her life to be quite satisfied with her husband Torvald in their doll's house in which she is the doll. However, with the development of the play, she is insulted by her husband for a forgery that she did for his sake even after knowing the truth. When the matter is solved, her husband tried to calm her down, but she becomes aware of her status in the doll's house and at once leaves it. Thus, she is the modern woman who fights against gender discrimination. Now here I present before you Nora from A Doll's House.
Sit down. No, Torvald, please, sit down. I have much to talk over with you. You don't understand me. Well, I have never understood you. Till tonight. No, don't interrupt. Only listen to what I say, Torvald. We must come to a final settlement. Does not one thing strike you as we sit here? We have been married 8 years. 8 years, Torvald, and this is the first time we two, you and I, man and wife, have talked together seriously. During 8 whole years and more, ever since the day we first met, we have never exchanged one serious word about serious things. I'm not talking. Torvald, no. Torvald, stop! I'm not talking about business! I'm saying that we've never yet set ourselves seriously to get to the bottom of anything. There we have it. You don't understand me. I have had great injustice done me to a world. First by father and then by you. You have never loved me. You only thought it amusing to be in love with me. Yes, it is the truth to a world. It is so. While I was at home with father, he used to tell me all his opinions. And I held the same opinions. If I had others, I concealed them because I knew he would not have liked it. He used to call me his doll child and used to play with me like I played with my dolls. And then I came to live in your house. I mean, I passed from father's hands into yours. You settled everything according to your taste. And I got the same taste as you. Or I pretended to. I don't know which. Both ways perhaps, I don't know. When I look back on it now, I seem to have been living here like a beggar from hand to mouth. I lived by performing tricks for you, Joel. But you would have it so. You and father have done me a great wrong. It is your fault that my life has been wasted.
In distress.
Who are you? Where are you coming from? And why are you here? You literally scared me. Are you a ghost? Oh no, spare me. I'm a sweethearted soul.
Why do mortals ask so many questions? Anyways, if you can tell already, I'm Athena, the goddess of wisdom. I know. You have a lot of questions. We're short on time today. So why don't we just skip to the part where you tell me what's wrong so that I can help you with that. Okay?
Good you came. I have tons of problems in my life and I don't know how to sort or start them from. The major part is I face difficulty in English, especially the grammar part, and people around me crack tons of joke on my language. Seriously, the problem I face is that I don't know how to ask a question or how to frame a question. And most of my doubts are just left unclear.
So framing questions, huh? Don't worry, I'll help you with that. You're lucky you have me here.
Yeah. Very lucky indeed. Why not see? I became a gem from a normal stone. Can we start? Since time is going and your damsel needs your help.
Yeah, of course. Let's start with the basics. That is, question structure. There are four main parts. First, we have the question words or question phrases. They are the words like how, who, how much, where, how long, etc. And second, we have the auxiliary words. Do you think you'll be able to give me some examples for that?
Maybe I can give it a try. Who is she? How long will it take? And where does he live?
Right. Third, we have the subject, like I, you, or we. Fourth, we have the main verb. It can be anything that you prefer, like play, eat, listen. These are the four main things things that you need, and you'll always need them in this order itself. So far, all good?
Yeah, I think I'm getting the hang of it.
Well, in that case, why don't you give me some examples?
Some examples, yes. How many bags are there? Whom did you see? Which dress did you like? Who said that?
Great. Now tell me of this type of question. Do you listen to pop music?
Oh yes. But well, is that a question? So it's also fine not to have a question word also.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, there are two types of questions.
Oh yes, I know that already. Questions that start with an auxiliary verb or a helping verb requires just a short answer and the detail is not very important. And open questions are those questions that start with a question and they require a more detailed answer, isn't it?
It is actually. But don't forget that in closed questions, the answer directly responds to the question, and in open question, the answer requires more information.
Yes, now I understand. Maybe can you see some examples for that? Open, what happened at the meeting, and closed, did the meeting go well?
Yeah, exactly. Now there's one more thing, and that is intonation. It is a way our voice rises and falls when we speak. In closed question, our voice goes up, and in open question, it goes down. You got that?
Yeah, I think I'm getting the hang of it.
Not bad. You know, you're not as boring as my previous model. You caught up pretty quick.
Wait, am I not the first human you're helping?
No, definitely not.
Wow, to think that I'm special.
It hurts, doesn't it? Anyways, I gotta run. Bye.
Bye. She made my day. I hope she comes back when her damsel is in distress again. She's not that bad. I like her. And now my questions are so perfect. She made me an English gem.
Can a word be its own a person? Yes, they're called consonants. Words which there are own antonyms depending on usage. Here are a few examples. Left can mean both remaining and departed. Remaining. No one had anything left to say. Departed. Example. He left without saying anything. Off can mean both activated and deactivated. Example. Set off activated. Switch off deactivated. Activated. Example. The explorer set off to conquer new territories. Deactivated. Example. He switched off the lamp. Oversight means both watchful care and an inadvertent error. Watchful care. Example. The new manager was given oversight of the project. An inadvertent error. Example, the error was a simple oversight. Screen can mean both to show and to hide. To show. Example, the screening of Anurag Basu's film was attended by many celebrities. To hide. Example, she used a sunscreen to avoid blemishes. Sanction can mean both a penalty for disobeying a law and official permission or approval for an action. A penalty. Example, a range of sanctions aimed for deterring incest abuse. Official permission. Example, the government will never sanction drinking and driving because it is unsafe. That's amazing English.
Dear all, let's hear some knowingly unknown facts. We are all familiar with the word Titanic. Of course, you got the image of the ship in your mind. But do you know the meaning of the word Titanic? It means gigantic, massive or vast. Yes, that's why even the ship was named so. Titanic has become one of the most famous ships in history, depicted in numerous works of popular culture, including books, folk songs, films, exhibits and memorials. The true stories of the unsinkable ship are more fascinating than any movie. Here are a few books to know more about the ship Titanic. Who Sank the Titanic by Robert J. Strange, Remembering the Titanic by Dean Ho, The Band That Played On by Steve Turner, A Night to Remember by Walter Law. Do check out these books, my dear friends. Even James Cameron, the director of the blockbuster hit Titanic, drew inspiration from A Night to Remember. Now it is time to see a graceful performance by our friends on Celine Dion's My Heart Will Go On.
Every night in my dreams, I feel you. That is how I know you go on. Across the distance and spaces between us, you have come to show you go on.
Nagarians. It's time to wind up this week's episode. Before that, let us remind you all that English department conducts monthly competitions. Thank you all who did participate in the August and September activities. Others, please do grab your opportunities. I thank our dear father, Binu Patarkalam, CMI, teachers, parents and all my friends for your support and encouragement. As Gayatri said in the introduction, happiness is love, thankfulness and spiritual. So I wish all of you a wonderful and splendid time ahead. Thank you once again and stay tuned for the next episode. This is Riya of 11D signing off. Bye!